That is a skit that you know well. And you may be wondering, okay, what does that have to do with what we're talking about this morning? Well, I think in some ways that video parallels Mark's gospel. In the sense that there is this thing in Mark's gospel, at least that scholars call as the messianic secret. Because it's fascinating, in Mark's gospel, all the people who should know who Jesus is don't know him. While all those that you wouldn't think would catch on, those you wouldn't think would go, ah, they get it. Even at times in the gospel, it is only the blind person who sees who Jesus is. There's this wonderful irony going on in Mark's gospel. Well, in that skit we just saw, the audience knows exactly what's going on. They see what is happening. Abbott, he knows exactly what he's trying to communicate here. I mean, he's kind of like Jesus, who in Mark's gospel is very clear on what he's attempting to communicate. Costello, on the other hand, he's not getting it. And he's like the disciples in Mark's gospel and others. You would think it would catch on, but they keep on asking, who? What? But in Mark's gospel, there is this additional character who shows up on the scene. And it's that person who gets it. And yet we would not expect that person to get it. For that, we turn to Mark's gospel, the first chapter, verses 40 through 45. And I invite you to hear these words. A leper came to Jesus begging him. And kneeling, he said to Jesus, if you choose, you can make me clean. Moved with pity, Jesus stretched out his hand and touched him and said to him, I do choose. Be made clean. Immediately, the leprosy left him, and he was made clean. After sternly warning him, Jesus sent him away, saying to him, see that you say nothing to anyone, but go and show yourself to the priest and offer for your cleansing what Moses commanded as a testimony to them. But the man went out and began to proclaim freely and to spread the word so that Jesus could no longer go into a town openly but stayed out in the country. And people came to him from every quarter. May God richly bless these words of Scripture. Before I offer a word of prayer, though, I want to just lift up. Today is Scout Sunday. That's Boy Scouts, Cub Scouts. Later on in the spring is Girl Scout Sunday. But I just want to celebrate. We have a few folks here in uniform. I want to celebrate the Boy Scouts that meet here at Cypress Creek. What a great group. And I just think making a difference in people's lives. So I honor them and celebrate them. Will you join me in prayer? For what is yet unlearned, provide us. Provide us an openness that we might discern, that we might embrace this gift yet unlearned. The gift that you believe we need for this day. O Lord, whose merciful kindness knows no end. Amen. Perhaps my favorite cartoon character of all time. For some, it will be a flashback. For others, may not know the character, though it's amazing how those that we have to look back to see often make a comeback. But that cartoon character is Droopy. There was just something about Droopy, this dispassionate, unexpressive dog. You know the one. I'm so happy. You know, no matter how hard he tried, he just was not terribly convincing. I have a feeling that if you were to think about it, you know a few people like Droopy. And I'm not just talking about people who are, you know, a little tired. We all get there at some time. No, I'm talking about people that just personify that lack of excitement and enthusiasm. Not only are there people in general, I think there are churches. I would suggest there are Christians that struggle with that. But in our passage this morning, there is no one at all that represents a droopy. Even when Jesus suggests to the man who has been cleansed that he should kind of keep a low profile for a while and go directly to those that would confirm his healing. That's what was proper in those days. Before you could re-enter society, someone who had some official title needed to say, yes, you have been made clean. Well, even with that, this man who has just experienced Jesus would not, well, he just could not embrace this notion of a traditional response. He could not stay within the established customs. His experience, the freedom in being, you know, released from the physical and social constraints of leprosy, this freedom that he has discovered could now not fit back into the constraints of some time-honored expectation. It just didn't fit. I'm sure he tried in that moment. He tried to do as Jesus requested, but he couldn't contain himself. And so he goes out on the streets and he shares what has happened. He announces to anyone and everyone who will listen what has occurred. It's just bursting forth. It reminds me a little of a musical. I love musicals. And the cheesier the musical, the better, in my opinion. I mean, it's amazing how things just happen. I mean, I grew up with the TV series Fame. Nowadays, it's Glee. And you know what I'm talking about. Something good happens. And all of a sudden, people just burst into song. And not just any old song. I mean, it's three-part harmony. And they all know the same choreography. But there is a musical that came out, Disney, the Teen Beach movie, and I want to invite you to watch this little clip from it.
What's going on? This can't be happening. Don't tell me it's a song.
It's a song.
This wasn't how I planned it. Can't you see that this has gone too far? Please just pause the DVR. Someone, won't you make it stop? I'm losing my mind.
I don't see your problem.
Everything I say, it rhymes. Here comes another line.
Just close your eyes if you don't wanna see.
What's this choreography? Someone, won't you make it stop?
It stop.
Amazing how all of a sudden there's a place for tap dancing and the shoes got changed somewhere in the middle of it. I love that. And if I was to offer a confession, I've kind of always dreamed of having one of those moments where you just break out in song and begin dancing out, you know, on the street corner. What keeps me from doing it is I can't sing, and ask my wife, I can't dance. So, you know, that holds me back just a little bit. the seams of respectful and conventional behavior. So there's sometimes in moments when it feels as if they're beginning to rip apart. I mean, there's just something within you that you want to just let go of and celebrate. But I think in those moments, at least most of those moments, our response is to hold back, to pull back. And something begins to dampen the enthusiasm. Something begins to extinguish the spark. And what was an expanding joy is suddenly reversed, and it begins to deflate like the balloons we bought for my mother's birthday recently that sat in the corner. And as the days progressed, they got smaller and they kind of got droopy. I mean, it happens whether we want it to happen or not. Sometimes it's our choice. Sometimes it's pressures, or at least perceived pressures from the outside. Something that hits us and squashes and begins to deflate the jubilation. I grew up at First Christian Church in Lincoln, Nebraska. We had wonderful worship in that church, but it was traditional worship. A lot like our 11 o'clock service, though I would take it another step. We truly embodied the frozen, chosen kind of attitude. And I remember in that church one Sunday, Reverend Colby getting up and announcing to the congregation that the following Sunday, our custodian and his wife, who were members of another church, were going to be bringing their band to lead worship. There was this sound in the space of, you would see people kind of talking amongst themselves upon hearing this news. I mean, I think the first thought among some were, oh, well, we're going to have an organ and piano duet. But that was not the band that was being brought into the sanctuary. And to my surprise, the following Sunday, attendance was up. I think a lot of people just came to see what it was going to be like. And we walked into that very, very traditional sanctuary, and on the chancel were drums and guitars. And people sat down, but there was a little anxiousness, nervousness in the sanctuary. When they finally began to play, they were fabulous. I mean, it was a combination of rock and gospel, even taking some traditional hymns, as Stephanie does sometimes, and putting them to a different feel. And this congregation, this traditional congregation, was very respectful. We all sat there, our eyes forward, our hands in our lap. We occasionally made a glance one direction or another, but that was to see how certain people were reacting. How are the Wilcox responding to this? How's Miss Thurber reacting? How about Miss Smith? I was sitting up in the balcony with my mother, and occasionally I found my hand tapping on my thigh, but my mother gave me that glance, and I ceased tapping on my thigh during the song. And then at one point, during one of their songs, a pillar in the life of that congregation, I knew her only as the Hat Lady, because she had a different hat every Sunday of the year. All of a sudden, she began to clap. It was not terribly enthusiastic, and I would suggest it wasn't even with the beat. But it was like someone had uncorked a bottle under pressure. It was amazing what happened. Now, don't get me wrong, it was no Pentecostal revival here, no. But people began to clap, and people began to sing along on the songs that they knew, and a few people even stood up and started clapping. That congregation never stood up unless the pastor told them to stand up. This was completely unexpected. And yet people were touched by the joyous music that was full of grace and faith, and it was interwoven with scripture and testimony. And clearly people were moved. Yet tradition and a few stern looks almost deflated that joy within us. But what was brewing within each person in that sanctuary suddenly got the nod. And it was as if the seams in people's spirits begin to rip apart. All it took was the hat lady starting to clap, and all of a sudden it unleashed that sense of joy that people were feeling. Now, the following Sunday, worship was back to its usual ways. Except, I would suggest from that point on, people sang with their heads up a little more. And people sang with a little more enthusiasm. And even on the hymn, "How Great Thou Art," I occasionally saw a little head bob. Small, but a head bob nonetheless. Now, I use the example there of the spiritual seams being torn apart in the context of worship. But notice the passage. Our scripture this morning, it describes this man who has found healing, transformation in his life. He had been confined by leprosy, confined physically and emotionally and culturally. And now he has been freed from that. And does he go to the sanctuary to sing? Does he go into the sanctuary to praise? No. He goes out on the streets. He can't contain it. It just comes out from him. I think too often we come to church, come into this worship service so that we can cut loose a little bit and get it out of our systems. Because the last thing we want is it coming out of us somewhere out there. But this should be just our practice session. This should be just the place where we begin to work on it. Tony Campolo tells the wonderful story about early in his life being a camp counselor at a junior high church camp. He talks about that as an experience in and of itself. Well, there at that church camp, in his cabin with all those boys, there was a 14-year-old boy named Billy, who had cerebral palsy. And Tony was horrified to see how he was treated. He had difficulty walking, and the boys would get in behind him and mimic his walk. He had a difficult time speaking, often stuttering and very slow and deliberate. And the boys, after the lights went out in the cabin, would start laughing as they would try to imitate Billy. Tony tried to pull them aside one-on-one, sometimes small groups. He'd lecture them and try to preach at them, but nothing seemed to change them. And on the last full day of camp, it was a tradition that every cabin would choose an individual who would give testimony at worship that night on behalf of the cabin, and the boys chose Billy, thinking it would be hilarious. Again, Tony was just heartbroken, and Billy knew exactly what was happening and even debated about just saying no thank you, but he didn't. When worship came that night, after a number of the cabins had their representative give their testimony, it came time for Billy. And as he made his slow, awkward move to the podium, there were giggles and smirks among the boys. They wanted to see what would happen. And Billy had prepared a speech that consisted of 9 words, and it yet took him over a minute to say it. And yet what he said to the boys that day was, "God loves you. God loves me. I love you." And Tony described it as a night of miracles. First of all, junior high boys weeping, asking for forgiveness, receiving forgiveness, finding their lives transformed by that moment. And Tony says, to this day, a year does not go by where he does not run into one of those people that were a young person at that church camp, and they're still telling the story. They're still sharing that wonderful news of that transformative moment in their lives. The first time I heard that story told, it was told by my friend Kelly. It was at a youth retreat. The following Sunday, I was with my youth group, and they were talking about it. And I was amazed at what they were saying. They were saying, I was telling that story that Kelly told us about Tony Coppola. I was telling somebody else, I was too. I was telling that story. Somebody else, I was too. And then somebody said, oh, when it comes to Youth Sunday, I want to be the person that tells that story. And somebody else said, no, I want to be that person who tells that story. And as I listened to them, I realized that they had been out with friends at McDonald's and told that story that had touched their hearts. They had been at band camp, and they had told that story that had touched their heart. They'd been on the soccer field, and they told that story that had touched their hearts. If there is someone or something trying to stitch back up your jubilation, trying to dam up your delight, don't let them. We need to be a people that when we are outside these walls, look like a little kid waiting in a long line to go to the bathroom. We need to be those people about ready to burst. And yet, like the boy, unlike the boy, we need to hold. He needs to hold it. We need to let go of it. We need to make sure that what is in us gets out of us. And not just here. This is our practice. This is the place we warm up. We need to go from these seats, from this place, out into the world and to say to people, God loves you. God loves me. And then allow that love to spill from one to another. If we can do that, and I think we can, if we can do that, think of the difference it would make in our community, our world. You pray with me. There is joy. This joy that has its source with you, O Lord of life and love. This jubilant experience should not be contained or restrained, controlled or put on hold. No, Lord, we ask that you provide us words that we can put with the joy, that you give us faithful actions that help us to reveal that spirit, that growing spirit within each and every one of us. It has its origin with your love revealed to us in Jesus, a love that is growing, not only within us as individuals, but within this community. But God, we pray that what happens here is only the starting place. That when we are with friends, when we're at McDonald's, when we're on the soccer field, when we might be at band camp, wherever we might be, we pray, oh God, that you will loosen the stitches in our spirits and let this joy spill out. Gracious God, this morning, we are mindful of many in the life of our congregation. There are so many that are on the prayer list, people recovering from surgery or waiting for surgery, some waiting for a diagnosis, and others trying to determine what the proper treatment will be. And this morning, we lift up Emery, Gail, Burley, Ellen, Julia, Bill, Jerry, Pam, Barbara, Vicky, Ken, Lee, Joe, and Janet. We lift these people up to you, not so that you can do all the work. We lift them up because we believe that there is something that happens in prayer. But in the midst of it, some of what happens in this prayer is that we are the ones changed, Lord. And we become that instrument of love. we become the ones that declare to others that they are loved, not just with our lips, but with our very lives. We make it real for them. And God, we pray this day that you will continue to empower us, that you will help rip open those seams and allow the joy to spill out upon others. We ask this. We ask these thoughts, these words. We offer them in the name of Jesus. Amen.